If you have about £3,500 to spend on a micro, how about this? Yes, a 9-carat gold QL available from the London jewellers Asprey. But has the QL been a gold mine for Sir Clive Sinclair? And indeed, does the final production version of the QL exist yet? I'll be putting these and other questions to him later in the show. Sequence was written by Paul Rhodes on a Spectrum. Well done. As this is the last programme in the present series, and we have received so much good software from you, we have just closed our eyes and selected this last title sequence. Sadly, though, we have not received a single programme from any ladies.
Which I find totally amazing. However, if you own a BBC Micro and you've built the light software circuit, then this is your week, and we really do believe we've got it right this time. Place the circuit in position when the black dot appears and stand by then to press the space bar to download the software when the instruction tells you so to do.
Well, from the Spectrum to the QL, and welcome, Sir Clive.
Thank you.
Now, last week, David Carlin was here and was telling us that most of the initial problems with the QL had been overcome. Has it, in fact, been relaunched?
It's been relaunched, yes, in the sense that we've now got all the software, we've overcome all the problems, I may say, not just some of them, but all the initial problems, and so we've relaunched in the sense that we've shown to all our dealers and to all the software houses everything that's available for it. We now have a very wide range of software and, of course, a wide range of peripherals from other manufacturers.
Now, the QL didn't really address the mass market that you were hoping for in its sort of first launch. Is it mainly the software that you think is going to make it do that this time round?
Well, I don't think it was just the lack of software last year that made the results less than we expected. It was the early teething troubles and the fact that we just couldn't make the machines in the early part of last year. But now we've sold all that, but even allowing for that, we sold over 50,000 machines last year, which is more than any other serious machine. Clearly it's much less than the machine that sells principally on games, but that's not the category the QL is in. So we're very confident that it'll continue to be the very best-selling serious machine.
Now, some of those 50,000, you know, existing QL users have been writing to us. One problem they have at the moment is that you've now said that the QL club membership is now free. Mm-hmm. And they've asked us to put the question to you, can they get their £35 money back?
Well, we hope that they found the club valuable and they paid for it, so no, they can't. I mean, we did, that was a deal we did then, and we've got a new deal now.
So, no money back for the existing users.
No.
Now, the QL does use a sort of a non-standard operating system. It also uses the micro drives that we were talking about last year.
Non-standard. It's our standard.
It's, yes.
And you could say that the Spectrum is non-standard, but, because it's the most popular machine by far, then it is a standard in its own right.
Okay, but it's not compatible with a number of other machines that are available on the market.
Machines really are compatible with each other.
Right, but the question was really is, do you think that has addressed a problem that the software houses have had in terms of getting the software ready?
No, not at all. The software houses have had a problem with our machine and with, say, the Apple Macintosh, because the 68,000 chip was a lot to bite off. It's a very much more powerful chip than the Z80 that we've used previously, or the 6502 that Apple have used previously. It's a very powerful chip indeed, and it's taken the software houses longer than we or Apple expected to come to terms with it. The exciting thing is, and the other side of the coin is, that having achieved that, having come to terms with it, they're producing some very dramatic software indeed, and it's now coming through with a rush. They've solved their problems.
Right. Now, moving on from the QL, sort of slightly into the future, the most recent news from Sinclair Research is obviously of the portable. Can you let us know or give us some idea of what its main features will be?
Right. I can say something about it, though not all about it. It's the first portable machine from Sinclair will be out next year sometime. We haven't got an exact date. And the first machine will be Spectrum-based. The reason for it being Spectrum-based is there's so much software out there already for Spectrum and such a large user base. I mean, there are millions of people, literally, that have Spectrums who we believe will be potential customers for the portable. But the portable isn't just a Spectrum repackaged. It's a completely new machine, which is Spectrum compatible. And my feeling about portables is that eventually all machines will be portable. But what holds that back at the moment is that today's portables are a severe compromise in at least two ways. One is the display just isn't satisfactory.
Right.
Most portables use a liquid crystal display, and wonderful as that is a technical achievement, wonderful as that is as a technical achievement, the appearance is very deficient.
So you obviously have other plans for your display.
We have our own technology there, yes.
That you can talk about, or?
Yeah, well, I can say what it does. But may I just mention that the other deficiency, and that is price. I don't believe that anybody is going to, in the long term, I don't think that people in general are going to pay a premium price for a portable. What they need is a portable that is not a compromise in any sense, so that that can be the one machine they have, and has the additional advantage of portability at low cost and with batteries that will run for a long time.
Now, what about the display?
Well, our objective is to provide in a portable the same quality and appearance of display that you get in a monitor today, so that there's no compromise.
And what technology are you going to use to do that?
Well, that's our own in-house technology, and we can't reveal how we do it.
So wait and watch this space, then.
Yes.
Okay, now, at the same time, you announced news of wafer-scale integration. Can you give us some idea of what that is exactly?
Wafer-scale integration is making your memory all in one wafer, as is normally done, but instead of chopping it up and putting all the chips in different packages and throwing away the good ones and putting the bad ones, putting the good ones onto a board, not a laborious process, keeping them all on the wafer. Now, wafers have imperfections, so you need some special technology to do that. And we have a world lead in this. We're the first people, we believe, who have cracked all the problems. And we will be bringing out our first wafer product later this year, which will be a plug-in Winster equivalent, if you like, for the QL. So it'll be a small package that plugs into the end of the QL, does the same job as a Winster, but is very much more compact, very much lower power consumption, just runs off the QL power, and, of course, much more reliable. It's got no moving parts.
So you're getting completely away from the idea of... I mean, last week we were looking at micro drives and floppy disk drives as an alternative. You're going sort of two steps further...
That's right.
..into the wafer scale.
Yes. We knew, of course, right at the start, that one day the wafer scale would be there, and so we foresee the package being, you know, micro drives your program loading, and then the wafer scale giving you the highest speed in any drive of any sort anywhere.
Now, the wafers would also seem to be an ideal thing to put into the portable.
Yes, that's
right. So you have plans along that
side. Yes, the portable won't come out with a wafer drive in it, but we are planning a sort of upmarket portable, high performance portable, later on, which would have a wafer drive built in.
Okay, now these are wonderful plans, but at the same time you must realise that I think the Financial Times said you needed £50 million to get both these projects off the ground.
No. The £50 million is just for a new company entirely, which would make the wafers for the future. Not the first generation of wafers, that's already underway. This is for a completely new company, business indeed, to build an actual massive factory to make wafers.
Right. But at the same time, Guy Cooney is telling us sort of week after week on the news item that the city is really panicking about sort of investing in the high technology industries. What makes you think you'll be able to raise the money where other people have failed?
Well, two things. Our record and the record of the people that will be involved in the project.
Finally, Sir Clive, you're seen within the UK computer industry as an entrepreneur and sort of a hero, if you like. At the very beginning of the programme and the series, Guy Cooney asked for some ideas on the ultimate and perfect micro. Can we let the viewers have some idea of what your idea of the ultimate micro would be?
It'll be in the house, and you'll be able to talk to it, and it'll talk back to you. You'll sit down in front, and it'll recognise you and wish you good morning and mean it and understand everything you say. And you'll be able to ask it about your health and any problems you have.
Well, we look forward to seeing that, either from yourselves or from somebody else. So, Clive, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Well, I've no idea whether today is a typical day in the life of Sir Clive Sinclair, but he is a bit of a mega-star of the micro, so it's perhaps not very surprising that Micro Mega have produced this little game for the Spectrum, based on a hypothetical day in the life of Sir Clive, in which he gets up to all the things you'd expect him to do, going to the bank to deposit large sums of money, going to the palace to get knighted, and rushing round London in his C5, although I've always rather thought that he was more of an Aston Martin or a Porsche man myself. Well, that's their idea anyway. Now, this is the last programme in the present series until our sister programme Database returns in the summer. So what are you going to do with yourselves and your micros till then? Dr. Mike Thorne has some intriguing ideas for you to test yourself against.
If you've a computer about the house, it's surprising how much use you can make of bits and pieces of household rubbish thanks to this book by Gerald Bettridge. He really does seem to know what makes experiments fun. Retrieve the battery from a burnt-out old banger, drill a few holes in a car coffee maker, cannibalise the tea strainer. There we are. Pinch a small child's Lego set, making sure you get at least one motor, and put the whole lot together. What have you got? Well, if you add the circuitry given in Bettridge's book, you've got an automatic egg boiler. Plug it into a Commodore 64, and it will time your breakfast protein to perfection. I'm a simulated 3 minutes person myself, so here goes. And now it'll wait there until the water comes to boiling temperature and then time the egg to the 3 minutes. This egg boiler is just one of the excellent experiments described in the book, many of them worthy of Heath Robinson himself. Ours doesn't look quite like the original because it uses a mains-powered pan heater. Unless you really know what you're doing, I'd avoid connecting your own circuits with mains-powered devices other than the computer. The auto-distract candle is another device from the book. It detects the flame of a candle and then snuffs it out. Once the detector plate gets hot enough, the motor will start, the fan will spin round, and then the candle will be snuffed. If you think that's crazy, there are also more serious items, like a graph plotter circuit and a collection of smashing computer experiments for the Spectrum. Another excellent book of projects, this time for the BBC Micro only, is this by Bruce Smith. It includes a doorbell and rain detector, a light-operated switch, and this, a sound-detecting burglar alarm. A microphone is used to listen out for noise, and the resulting signal is passed down to this amplifier, and then converted to DC form before being passed onto the computer. Well, let's try it out. Imagine I was a burglar breaking in. I seem to have broken the glass. For younger viewers who fancy cutting their teeth on something simpler, I can recommend the Usborne series of books, and this one in particular. Half of the practical things it suggests involve just writing programs, but the other half of the book involves building circuits like this binary number display. You can get it to display either a given number in binary. Now, if we dim the light so that you can see, let's try 12. There we are, 8 and 4. Or to count down from a given number, let's try 7. 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. There's a slight bug in the component list here, however, as the binary numbers come out upside down if you use the transistor suggested in our copy, but it still works. Another book in the Usborne series gives complete instructions for building your own robot to work with Commodore 64, VIC-20, Spectrum and BBC Micros. How to make computer-controlled robots is handsomely produced and includes a complete list of the things you need to buy, all the tools you need, circuit diagrams for the electronics, indeed, everything. It says it's for the absolute beginner. So
first Lotus did it with the 1-2-3, then came Symphony. What next? You'll see in just a moment. But in the meantime, bear in mind what Mike Thorne said. Don't start connecting your experiments to the mains. We'd hate to see you fried. Now, a little jazz.
Ladies and gentlemen, meet the Lotus Most High Functional Jazz Quintet. Mr. William B. Moses on spread sheets. Tell me about it, sweet William. Jackie Sweet Talk and Samson will be handling communications. Jones on graphics. Processing words for you. Lester Lamont, the man you've already met. And a big hand for the last man in the band, Denny. The man with the facts and figures, Driscoll, on database.
To paraphrase the expression, wonderful video, but what about the software? Tony Pohl from Lotus, what exactly is Jazz?
Jazz is a new program from Lotus. It's an integrated program offering you word processing, database, communications, graphics, and spreadsheet, designed specifically for the Apple Macintosh.
But in fairness, the software for the Macintosh does give you those facilities somewhere, doesn't it?
You can buy individual packages. While Jazz offers you a very powerful features in each of those areas, and it's integrated. That means you can run them all together, mm-hmm. and you can take data from one part into the other very easily.
All right, we've got a really thrilling demo here, which is based on an exciting chart of future cocoa prices, isn't
That's
it?
Right.
Right, what can you do with that?
Cocoa prices in London over a number of months. I can point to the items there with my mouse. In here, I might want to add the average of these cells here.
Right.
So I'll tell Jazz with a pull-down menu to put a formula into that cell. I want the average formula here, so I'll tell it to enter it. It's asking me for an argument list, some numbers. So I point to the numbers I want,
yeah.
click on the cell, and there is the average.
Bang.
If I want to take a copy of that sort of formula into these cells, I tell Jazz, the pull-down menu, take a copy. I point to the cells I want, like that, and take the paste into there. And again, the calculations have gone all the way through.
It's actually making the Mac look quite fast as well, isn't it?
It is. Jazz makes it work very well.
All right, now presumably you can now readjust these figures into some other form, yes?
Yes, numbers are quite hard to understand as a form. Let's make a graph of these again. Select with your mouse like that. Tell Jazz to get a new piece of paper. And this time we'll have a piece of graph paper. So we point to the graph paper, tell it's going to be a new piece. And up it comes on the screen with new menus along the top.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to plot a line graph on a simple pull-down menu. So Jazz plots the line, sets your axes down here.
I see. Now, supposing we wanted to put the actual figures against the forecast figures, you can do that.
Let's go back to our spreadsheet. And we'll plot the forecast figures here, just by pointing to them. Go back to our graph. And again, telling Jazz with pull-down menu to plot a line. And there we have it.
Right. Well, what about a bit of word processing as well, a title
or
something?
We'll annotate it with this annotation icon. We'll click on that, make a box like this,
yep.
and say Jazz Graphics, which we can make larger if you want.
Mm-hmm.
And that's it. So there we have Jazz Graphics text in graphs.
And all part of the integrated system, and presumably you can dump this across to a printer.
Yes, we can dump it to a printer. We can include the graph in the word processing, the data in the word processing.
All right, Tony. How much and when available?
Okay, it'll cost £550. It'll be available in the spring.
I see. And will it be available for any other machine, or is it just for the Mac?
It's just for the Mac. Lotus has written Jazz specifically to make best use of the Mac.
Tony Powell, thank you very much indeed. So, if you ain't got a Mac, you ain't got Jazz.
After an uncharacteristically quiet period of preparation, Commodore has produced its new business micro, and as you can see, it's a clone of the IBM PC. And to prove it, we're running Lotus 123. Commodore observes that the IBM costs 40% more. This one is only £1,675 plus VAT. Not everybody is going to be knocked out. After all, the PC is nearly 4 years old, and IBM itself is close to announcing a PC too. Still, better late than never. And now for something completely different.
You're not really going to do it, are you? I mean, not the joke.
The joke.
Oh. All right, then, go on.
Knock, knock.
Who's there?
Ben.
Ben who?
Ben Knox with Modem Corner.
Oh.
Hi there. Over the last few weeks on Modem Corner, we've looked at a variety of international communications networks, like, for example, CompuServe and The Source. I thought for the last program, we'd look at a local system that I think provides a very real and useful service, teleshopping, a system for handicapped or homebound people that allows shopping from your sitting room. Let me show you how it works. Just tee it up and start it running. Oh, sorry, this isn't working. I'll have to... Okay, let me try that again. Well, to hell with this, I'm watching The Muppets.
Perhaps the subject that is being discussed more than any other in offices around the world today is computers. Yes, the computer is becoming as common as the water cooler.
Hey, Leo.
Hmm?
Leo, you know that takeout pizza place around the corner?
Yeah, what about it?
What, do you have that telephone number?
Why, Grump, ask the computer.
Well, no, see, I just want a pizza.
But that's the wonderful thing about an office computer. It handles all those pesky little jobs, freeing you for meaningful activity. Our computer has a powerful telephone directory program.
Yeah, well, Leo, see, I've only had maybe a couple of lessons on this thing here. Hey, I think I'll just go get the pizza myself now.
Okay? But wait, Grump. What? Do not fear the machine. Now, if you'll just turn to the terminal here, I will help you.
This thing here, the terminal, it's called?
That's right.
Okay, well, so what do I do?
Okay. Well, to invoke the telephone directory program, first boot the system. Then B-load CPN load integer into the language card. Check the ROM, turn on the RAM, put the floppy disk in DOS, and type run.
This is going to get me a pizza.
Oh, yeah.
All right. Boot the system, then B-load CPN. Load integer into the language card. Check the ROM, turn on the RAM card, put the floppy disk in the DOS, and type run. I.O. error, faulty string function commanded DOS. Now, what does that mean, Leo?
Oh, Grump, you loaded Fortran instead of integer.
Well, all I want is this pizza, you know?
Okay, well, listen, here's what you do to get out of this. You boot the system, invoke CPN, turn on the CRT, download PIPCOM, type CHR8, and run.
All right. Boot the system, invoke CPN, turn on the CRT, download PIPCOM, type CHR8, and run. DBO error, faulty operator at keyboard. Hey, Leo, let's forget the whole thing, you know?
But we want a pizza.
You want a pizza? Okay, you got it. All right. All we do is boot the system and invoke Papa Luigi. Now, download the mozzarella, format the pepperoni, patch the marinara, poke the linguine, and load the floppy disk. Now, Leo, due to the wonders of computer science...
But, Grump, that won't interface.
Ha-ha! That's the way you get the pizza. Right in a face.
Meet me in the lobby. I know a great little Chinese restaurant.
Joking aside, teleshopping really is a very good idea. You can purchase virtually anything from a pizza to a presidential suite. Let me show you how. Boot the system, invoke Papa Luigi, download the marinara, format the pepperoni, pack the marinara, poke the linguine. I hope you like your pizza well done.
Judy's pizzas, they are the best. A megabyte better than the rest.
Cunies, Olivetti pizzas with crushed acorn oil.
What an idiot. Dude, I think that just about wraps it up, doesn't it, Jane?
It does. Well, hopefully we've shown you that computers are serious, they can be business-like, but above all, remember, computing can be fun.
Indeed it can. And we've had a lot of fun on this series. We hope to have a lot of fun on our sister programme, Database, when it returns on ITV in June. See you then. Bye-bye.
Morning software transmission is from ASK Software for the BBC Micro. Oh,